The Willows and Beyond by William Horwood, read by Richard Briers. It was late September, and after a week of storms and rain, which had caused the river to rise, and the once glorious vegetation along the river bank to grow old and bedraggled, the sun started to show itself again. Now, with a new dawn, the day promised a time of calmer, drier weather, and the final touch of an Indian summer. A thin veil of mist hung over the river, and all seemed subdued and at peace. The mole, who had not been able to leave Mole End for some days, had left Nephew to busy himself with a few necessary repairs to the windows and doors before winter set in, and had gone off for the day to see his good friend, the Water Rat. He had reached the iron bridge and was leaning on its parapet to gaze down at the river and watch its endless flow, when he noticed somebody sitting a little way along the bank, hardly more than a misty silhouette.
"Is that you, Otter?" he called.
"Hello, Mole,"
said the otter, rising to join him. Then, seeing the fat wicker luncheon basket he carried, he added,
"You're not off to see Ratty, are you? I'd leave Ratty well alone today if I were you, Mole. He's communing with the river, and has been since yesterday."
"Ah," said the mole, putting down his basket. "At such a time, Ratty's best left by himself."
The otter continued to stare down at the river and seemed unusually quiet and distracted for one normally so cheerful.
"Is something amiss along the river?" inquired the mole anxiously.
"I think there may be," said the otter, "though what it is I cannot say. I've known Ratty commune with the river many times before, we all have, but not for quite so long and not so seriously."
"Well, we certainly shouldn't disturb him," said the thoughtful mole. "But we can be at hand when he has finished, for he'll be tired and in need of good food and company."
So it was agreed, and the two spent the day at Otter's house, sending Otter's son Porkly downriver from time to time to see how Ratty was getting on. Both of them knew that if there were one animal along the river bank who understood the river's moods better than any other, and who heard its call more clearly than them all, it was the Water Rat. Come spring, summer, autumn, or winter, a day rarely went by when the rat was not either in the water or on it, swimming or sculling, thinking and dreaming. If he did have to be away from the river bank for social or business reasons, he was restless and uneasy till he was back in touch with the river again. For the most part, the rat called the river she, and none thereabouts doubted where his heart and spirit lay, or what was the source of his deepest joy and happiness, and, for that matter, his sporadic moods and silences. The riverbank has never questioned the rat for a single moment on those occasions, happily rare, and usually at times of spring and autumn spate, when he warned others off the river and told them to leave her alone for a time. His chief confidant and helper in such difficult times was the otter, who lived as close to the river as the rat, and was as adept as he in managing her more violent moods of storm and flood. When it came to matters of river history and lore, however, the otter deferred to the rat's greater knowledge and wisdom. It was one of the quiet pleasures of the river bank to see the rat and the otter conferring about the changing mood of the river, sitting upon the bank, their feet dangling in the water, their voices low. It was no wonder, then, that the otter was so concerned about this latest episode. But as the September day wore on into a balmy evening, and still Portly reported that there was no change, they began to think that something very serious indeed was afoot. The mole was just beginning to consider that he might go home for the night and return in the morning, when Portly came running along the bank.
"He's moved! He's up and he's stretched, and he's gone back into his house and shut the door."
"I think this is a matter for you now, Mole, old fellow," said the otter. "You're a better judge than I as to whether or not Ratty is at home to visitors."
They quickly gathered together what remained of the feast the mole had prepared, added a few things from the otter's more workaday larder, and the mole set off to see if his friend might be lured back into society.
"Ratty," called the mole, having tapped at his door. "Are you there, Ratty?"
"You know perfectly well I am," said an irritable voice from inside Ratty's house.
Well, then, are you at home to visitors? Because I brought you some..."
The door opened a little, and two bright eyes peered out.
"Some what?"
Oh, nothing very much, just a little bit of supper, because I know that at such times you could do with a bite or two, and that a well-made warming drink would not go amiss.
The rat opened the door completely and looked at the contents of the mole's basket with unabashed pleasure.
Is it very bad, the news you have from the river? Said the mole.
The rat abruptly turned his attention from the basket to the mole, and his expression changed.
I think it may be, Mole. For her call these past 2 days have been strange. She worries me. She worries me a great deal. I cannot say that I fully understand what she has been trying to say to me since yesterday, for the river does not use language like you or I, but speaks to us in a deeper way. Very often it is I who do not understand her, but I think that on this occasion she is not able to speak at all clearly of what her concerns are. It is as if she is calling for help, but that she knows we cannot give it. I do not know what it can be, but it's certain it's important and threatens her very life, and possibly our own.
It had been a long day and a worrying one, but the mole always said that a good night's sleep cleared the mind and made things look different, and very often a good deal better, and often he was right. If he had hoped for a lie-in, however, he was disappointed, for the sun seemed barely to have risen when there was a rat-tat-tat at the door.
Oh, that must be Ratty, he said, as he rose from his bed and searched for his dressing gown. He must have made a bit more sense of what the river was trying to tell him and come over at once to tell me.
Rat-tat-tat went the knocker once more, rousing Nephew from his slumbers. Grumbling a little and calling to Ratty to be patient, if you please, the mole slid back the bolts and finally opened the door.
Ratty, you're always welcome, began the mole, but do remember that not everybody is as wide awake at this hour as...
But it was not the rat. It was a solid gentleman in a blue and red uniform, and he carried a brown canvas satchel with a red crown upon it, above which were embroidered the words, Royal Mail.
You're Mr. Mole of Mole End, I take it, seeing as you're mole-like and your house is named Mole End?
That is correct, concurred the mole.
So you're not Mr. Water Rat, and nor is he, I take it, since he too is mole-like.
Nephew had appeared at the door behind the mole, and the postman was staring at him rather suspiciously.
Neither of us is the Water Rat, said the mole, feeling that simple agreement was the best approach with this gentleman.
If Mr. Rat does not live here, where does he live?
On the other side of the river, said the mole, pointing down through the trees. It's about half an hour or so if you go back the way you've come and over the iron bridge, but a good deal quicker by boat. I could perhaps take the letter or package to Ratty myself. He is a good friend.
Sir, I would not repeat that suggestion if I were you, because purloining mail is deemed a criminal rather than a civil offence. In any case, it isn't a letter.
Not a letter,
said the mole, feeling that repetition of what was said to him was the safest approach.
Nor a package, not even an address unknown return to sender. No, sir, we don't often get to deliver one of these, and seeing as it's caused me so much trouble, I'm not sure I want to deliver another one.
He dug deep into the bag.
This, he said, is a customer instruction to collect. That's on this side. And customer permission to receive and take away. That's on this side. Collect from the town head post office, that is, seeing as the item is too big or bulky or in some other way not party to the normal regulations. Clearly, we cannot, as postmen, undertake the risk to our persons of delivering such items, so the customer must take it upon himself.
What is the nature of the item?
Asked Nephew, as curious as his uncle.
I am not permitted to tell you that, said the postman. But there is nothing to prevent me reading what is upon the card, and nothing to prevent you hearing me do so.
He held up the card, squinted at it long and hard, and uttered a single and most startling word.
Livestock, he said.
I beg your pardon, said the mole.
Livestock.
And Mr. Rat is to collect it?
Or them, sir. You never can tell with livestock.
Are you permitted to read anything else on the card which may give us a clue about this matter? Continued the mole, his curiosity undeniable.
The only other item that may have relevance, sir, and beyond this I know nothing myself, for incoming mail and other items is a different department, of course, concerns the source of said item. That often gives a clue. Well, then, the source is given as Egypt.
Oh, my, said the mole,
whose knowledge of Egyptian livestock was restricted to camels.
Oh, my.
A sentiment with which I wholeheartedly agree, sir.
At which the mole suggested that he and Nephew guide the postman to the rat without more delay by way of the river. The walk down to the bank was pleasant and affirmed the promise of the dawn. And as the mole had expected, the rat was already out on his side of the river, busying himself about his boat and moorings.
Mole, just the fellow I was hoping to...
He stopped the moment he saw the postman, with a look of surprise and inquiry on his face. The matter was very soon explained, however, if not yet understood. Over came the rat in his boat in a trice.
It must be a mistake, said the rat finally, when the card had been read several times and the matter had been fully explained to him. I know nobody in Egypt, and I've certainly not ordered any camels.
It can't be helped, I'm afraid, sir. Rules are rules. We, that is the Royal Mole, assumed responsibility for this item the moment it touched the shores of the land, but you took up that same responsibility once you had acknowledged receipt, if only mutely, which is to say through silent reading of the card. Then, allowing for a day's grace once you are informed of said livestock's presence, you must pay storage charges at a rate of 6 pence a day minimum. Be warned, sir, those charges soon mount up.
Oh, dear, Ratty, you had better collect it today, said the mole.
Perhaps you'd come with me, mole, and nephew too, for if this livestock proves to be a herd of something, rather than a single specimen, then I shall need a good deal of help.
He sighed and looked about the river with considerable misgiving, for the morning was turning glorious, and a journey to the town was never to his taste, particularly on so promising a day as this, and with the river's warning of yesterday still so much on his mind.
"It'll take me a good deal more than a day to get there in my boat," said the rat, "for I shall have to row all the way. There's nothing for it but to borrow Toad's motor launch."
Having escorted the postman to the iron bridge and said their farewells, and with the collection card carefully stowed away in Rat's inside pocket, they marched purposefully up to Toad Hall to see if they might borrow Toad's launch for the day. It had been some time since any of them had seen Toad. They found him in the great hall by his front door, studying a good many packing cases of all shapes and sizes, of which he had evidently recently taken delivery. They all had upon them the imprint of the town's best-known emporium for the better classes, and the stencil words in black, immediate delivery. Toad's greeting, normally so effusive and generous-hearted, was on this occasion subdued. He was sitting in a chair, eyeing the cases as if he were summoning up the energy and courage to deal with an unwelcome guest.
Oh, hello, he said in a preoccupied way. Is this perhaps some new equipment for your home? Suggested the mole, his curiosity getting the better of him. My home? No, muttered Toad. Nor even for me. Now, what can I do for you?
It was plain that Toad did not wish to be pressed further, so the rat quickly explained why they so much needed to borrow his launch. Toad was only too happy to oblige, but as for going with them...
Much as I would like to, you fellows really must try to understand that I have a good deal to attend to today. You see, in addition to this delivery I have to deal with, he's coming home today.
Who? Inquired the puzzled rat.
Master Toad? Asked the mole quietly. You just have to do your very best to have a good time without me, said Toad, showing them out onto the terrace. You know where my craft is, Ratty, and how it works, just as well as I do. Better, in fact. Now off you go, for I have so much to do.
With that he dashed inside, as the others made their way down to his boathouse. In no time at all the rat had the motor launch out on the river, and had turned it expertly upstream towards the town. While behind them, though the river bank was aflame with autumn sun, the river itself was still and sombre, its surface seeming already to reflect the dark hues of approaching.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.